Recorded Books and RB Digital present The New Global Roadmap, Enduring Strategies for Turbulent Times by Pankaj Ghemawat. Narrated by Firdous Bamji. Foreword. Pankaj Ghemawat has been a path-breaking thinker and strategist throughout his career, and it is my privilege to have been a friend for many of those years. I first met Pankaj in 2001 when he shared his expertise on globalization and its context for strategy development at Tata Consultancy Services, TCS. Founded in 1968 as India's first software company, TCS is a member of the Tata Group of companies and has over 371,000 employees operating across 45 countries across the globe. Pankaj became an anchor of TCS's core strategy group, and his ability to dispassionately analyze issues and to read the tea leaves on the trajectory of the global markets, often contrary to the prevalent rhetoric, has been extremely helpful to the organization's overall growth and success. Back in early 2001, when the Asian financial crisis and its aftermath were keeping us awake at night, Pankaj maintained a steady view that the gloom and doom was overdone. Before the global financial crisis, when the world was supposedly becoming flat, Pankaj persuaded us that it was not a foregone conclusion, not even for Indian software companies. His counsel was so valuable that we soon referred to the core strategy meetings as the, quote, Pankaj Ghemawat sessions, unquote, and later the, quote, PG sessions, unquote. In the new global roadmap, Pankaj continues to insightfully question betting on globalization extremes. He examines a topic that has come under scrutiny again after Brexit and the election of President Trump, interweaving his experiences as an academic and a strategy consultant to portray a more pragmatic and balanced view. As always, Pankaj sets himself apart by using robust data to bring his story to life. His work on the DHL Global Connectedness Index, he tells me an accumulation of almost 2 million data points, supports his view that globalization will neither disappear nor expand at warp speed. As a business leader, the yo-yo of localization versus globalization he speaks of has strong implications for our companies. In the first part of this book, he guides managers to take a measured view, cautioning against both the leadership cadres becoming too enthralled by the extent and impact of globalization, and it succumbing to excessive pessimism about globalism's prospects. Amid the overheated rhetoric and violent market swings, Pankaj manages to find stable patterns that can help business leaders steady themselves and their organizations. These are the patterns he calls the laws of globalization. The second part of his book addresses many of the practical issues that concern even the most seasoned manager. Should firms scale globally or strengthen locally? Should organizations decentralize power to regional management? And if so, how? Pankaj outlines various ways that firms can improve organizational readiness in the face of globalization through levers such as culture, innovation, and his novel take on public affairs engagement. Pankaj is unique in his ability to connect theoretical rigor to practical decision-making on the ground. I highly recommend this book, and Pankaj's sensible approach more generally, as a crucial voice to counter the oftentimes bombastic nature of our current dialogue on the future of globalization. N. Chandrasekharan. Introduction. When I wrote my first book on globalization, Redefining Global Strategy, in 2007, the prevailing sense among executives was that companies could safely bet on globalization continuing to increase. As I finish this book a decade later, some business leaders, such as Alibaba founder Jack Ma, still believe that more globalization is inevitable. But most of the talk about globalization has turned pessimistic. Some of the negativity reflects, of course, recent shocks, most notably Brexit, as in the United Kingdom's vote to exit the European Union, and the election of Donald Trump as US president. I refer to these two events jointly as Brump. But the mood had already soured before then. In May 2016, a month before the Brexit vote, Jeffrey Immelt, then chairman and CEO of General Electric, told the graduating New York University MBA class that it was time for a, quote, bold pivot, unquote, toward localization in response to rising protectionism. Brump continued this shift. Having a global strategy seemed to swing from an absolute necessity to an outright risk. Only a week after Trump's inauguration, in January 2017, The Economist's cover announced, quote, the retreat of the global company, unquote. In figuring out what to make of such opinions and, more generally, the state of globalization, we need to remember that the present turbulence is not entirely new. While the process we now refer to as globalization has been going on for hundreds or perhaps even thousands of years, people's hopes for it have tended to overshoot reality and then come crashing back down for centuries as well, what I call the globalization yo-yo effect. While yo-yos are fun to play with, the globalization yo-yo effect is dangerous for firms and economies, making it more like yo-yo dieting than harmless childhood play. As venture capitalist Peter Thiel put it back in 2008, quote, for the past three centuries, the great rises and falls of the West track the high and low points of the hope for globalization, as have the peaks and valleys of the stock market. Almost every financial bubble has involved nothing more nor less than a serious miscalculation about the true probability of successful globalization, unquote. Postscript. Thiel, a major donor to Trump's 2016 campaign, agrees that with Trump's election, the globalization yo-yo is on a downswing. Quote, no one in their right mind would start an organization with the word global in its title today. That's so 2005. It feels so dated. Unquote. Indeed, 2005 is a signal year in terms of the last upswing of the globalization yo-yo. That year, Thomas Friedman's The World is Flat was published, going on to become the best-selling book about globalization ever. Amid the flat world hysteria in the run-up to the 2008 global financial crisis, it was easy to forget that less than a decade earlier, globalization expectations had experienced a downswing rather than an upswing. In the late 1990s, the euphoria after the fall of the Berlin Wall ran headlong into the Asian financial crisis. Business anxiety back then was so high that a leading strategy consulting firm convened a set of thought leaders in early 2001 to examine the implications for companies. I teamed up with one of the firm's partners to frame the discussion for a, quote, global salon, unquote. Our presentation at that salon highlighted many of the global issues that business leaders today are thinking about again in the present pessimistic environment. Should strategies switch from the pursuit of scale to local responsiveness? Should firms' geographic presence be narrowed to reduce risk? Should organizational power be pushed out to region and country leaders? And should multinationals try to act and look like their national counterparts in their dealings with governments and societies around the world? Our lead example for raising these questions and the answers that were being considered in 2001 was Coca-Cola, judged at the time to possess the world's most valuable brand as well as its broadest geographical footprint. As James Quincy, who became CEO in 2017, put it, quote, Coke went global before globalization. The way that worked is, you are now in charge of country X, go away, good luck. There's only two rules. You can't change the formula, and you can't steal the money. Please come back once a year and tell me how it's going. That was the model for 100 and something years, unquote. But after Roberto Goizueta became CEO in 1981, as globalization was gathering momentum, Coke shifted gears. Goizueta emphasized growth based on Coke's mega brands, expanded its presence from 160 countries to nearly 200, and engaged in an unprecedented amount of centralization by consolidating divisions and putting consumer research, creative services, and TV commercials under Coke's internal ad agency, with the idea of standardizing them. The stock price soared, and Fortune rated Coke as the most admired U.S. corporation for several years running. Douglas Ivester, who took over when Goizueta died unexpectedly in 1997, continued with this strategy. Quote, no left turns, no right turns, unquote, as he put it, but ran into the Asian crisis as well as governmental problems, particularly in Europe. Regulators in the EU resisted Coke's attempts, directed out of its headquarters in Atlanta, to acquire Orangina from Pernod Ricard and a set of soft drink brands from Cadbury Schweppes. Delays in tackling contamination problems caused further strain. Coke's market capitalization collapsed from a peak of $220 billion to below $120 billion as analysts marked it down for its global exposure, and Ivester was fired. Douglas Daft took over in 2000 and yo-yoed back toward localization. With his manifesto of, quote, think local, act local, unquote, thousands of jobs were cut at headquarters, and decision-making authority was sent back out to the field. This was how far we took the Coke story at the Global Salon in early 2001. We ended our presentation with a question. Were these extreme swings, made in response to shifting sentiments about globalization, truly warranted? With 15-plus years of additional history, the answer to that question from Coke's perspective was clearly no. The problems with unprecedented localization were quick to surface. Scale economies suffered, as did the quality of marketing. Country managers were simply unprepared for their expanded set of responsibilities. In 2002, Coke brought marketing oversight back to headquarters. That task itself a challenge because hiring a new team took longer than firing the old one. But growth continued to lag investor expectations, and Daft resigned in 2004. It fell to Neville Isdell, who took over from Daft, to strike the right balance between these extremes. What merits particular attention in this context, given the correspondence between Coke's yo-yoing and some of the recommendations being urged on companies today, is how costly this back and forth turned out to be for Coke. Despite the company's manifest strengths, it took the better part of a decade and probably tens of billions of dollars to get recentered. Coke is, of course, just one case in point, but its experience should not be discounted. Although history may not repeat itself, it sometimes does rhyme. Instead of simply succumbing to shifts in sentiment and yo-yoing between extremes as Coke did, companies should take a long, hard look at globalization before deciding how they're going to deal with it. This book attempts to help you with that task. Part 1 looks at where globalization has been and where it might go, and Part 2 explores the implications for the globalization-related choices that companies must confront. Let me expand slightly on that one-sentence book outline, part by part and chapter by chapter. Part 1 focuses on the challenges of mapping globalization at a time of great turbulence. It deploys a range of empirical approaches, relying on up-to-date data, peering inside the minds of people, specifically managers, with surveys, using analytics and statistical inference, analyzing stretch scenarios in depth, learning from history, and, most importantly, identifying robust regularities that offer guidance for the future. No math is required of the reader, but I include much data and many analyses of patterns in the data. As the late Daniel Patrick Moynihan put it, while everyone is entitled to their own opinions, everyone is not entitled to their own facts. The individual chapters in Part 1 focus on different time frames. More specifically, Chapter 1 looks at the data on globalization from past to present and concludes it does not yet indicate that we are in the grips of a globalization apocalypse. The data does support two laws: the law of semi-globalization, which posits that globalization is neither nearly zero nor complete, and the law of distance, which posits that the cross-border interactions that do take place are dampened significantly by distances of various types between countries. Looking at the data and juxtaposing it with estimates from surveys of managers and other groups also highlights the importance of guarding against globaloney, the pernicious tendency to overstate how globalized the world actually is. This habit turns out to be costly to business as well as society. Chapter 2 focuses on the short to medium run future, and in particular, on a way forward in a world that is, as military strategists put it, VUCA, VUCA, volatile, uncertain, complex, and ambiguous, and subject to shocks we can't even anticipate. Analysis of historical shocks, most notably the global trade war of the 1930s, during which the value of world trade fell by two-thirds over a three-year period, confirms that the laws of globalization continued to apply. Analysis of recent shocks, most notably Brexit, illustrates how helpful they are when looking ahead. The chapter concludes with a discussion of the broad implications of a VUCA world for business decision-making. Chapter 3 focuses on the longer run, on a success scenario in which there is relatively robust growth globally. It looks at one of the indispensable elements of such a scenario: significantly faster growth in emerging economies, particularly in emerging Asia, than in advanced ones. Because of demographics, it's hard to devise scenarios in which emerging economies don't grow faster, but there is robust global growth anyway. This big shift, south by southeast, helps anchor a discussion of several trends likely to manifest themselves over the next decade and beyond. The chapter also paints a broad picture of the differences in business environments in emerging versus advanced economies, and in their patterns of international engagement. And it starts to consider differences in where enterprises from emerging economies and advanced economies are coming from as a way of beginning to predict where these businesses might go. Part 2 of this book moves from mapping globalization to managing it at the company level, with the intent of helping managers do more than bounce between opposite extremes. The four chapters in Part 2 each address one of the four broad dimensions of choice: strategy, presence, architecture, and non-market strategy, span. Since this is a large body of content to cover, the focus is kept squarely on how companies can respond to the evolving challenges of competing across borders and distance. Each chapter offers recommendations that are organized for mnemonic purposes, into acronyms and elaborated on. The advice in these chapters extends beyond just keeping one's balance between eternal opposites to lay out a richer palette of possible responses. Chapter 4, on strategy, explains why pure adaptation to local conditions, while talked up during downswings, is likely to work out no better for most multinationals than it did for Coca-Cola under Daft. It also discusses why strategies of pure aggregation in the pursuit of scale economies, which Coke came close to embodying by the end of Goizueta's reign, tend to be too extreme as well. And the chapter goes beyond suggesting striking the right balance between adaptation and aggregation in two ways. First, it specifies more than 24 levers and sub-levers that can improve the trade-off between adaptation and aggregation. Second, and even more broadly, it suggests thinking of three AAA strategies: adaptation and aggregation and arbitrage, rather than picking a point on the continuum between the first two. Chapter 4 also discusses how emerging economy enterprises do relatively well at arbitrage and incumbent multinationals from advanced economies at aggregation. And the chapter then looks at the strategic implications for both types of enterprises. In particular, given the rise of, quote, insurgents, unquote, from emerging economies, incumbents from advanced economies will often need to pursue a mix of the AAA strategies. Chapter 5, on presence, tries to avoid overconfidence about global expansion during upswings and funk during downswings by looking at the basic logic of multinational presence. The law of distance, as applied to foreign direct investment, FDI, packs a big punch here, and only partly because of the large effects of cultural, administrative, geographic, and economic, CAGE, cage, distance. The cage distance framework supplies the basis for a logic of presence that makes business sense regardless of the prevailing mood about globalization. And by overlaying cage-based cross-border analysis with the characteristics of the countries, industries, and firms actually involved, readers can think through the implications for their own companies. Both qualitative and quantitative examples are provided. Chapter 6, on architecture, expands on questions of how to organize. It begins by reviewing how a firm's strategy should affect its organization, why adaptation typically requires some decentralization, why aggregation requires some centralization, and why arbitrage is often facilitated by a strong, cross-cutting functional axis. As a result, multinationals that employ all three AAA strategies tend to have complex structures. But structure is only part of what is required. They also need to rewire themselves within and without, including forging new connections at the top. The acronym UNITED denotes a range of ways firms can boost their organizational capacity to bridge borders and distance, a unifying culture, networked innovation, initiatives and task forces, technology enablers, expatriation and mobility, and development programs. Finally, Chapter 7 is about non-market strategy, or business engagement with the wider world. Strategists have typically treated non-market strategy as an afterthought to market strategy, but non-market issues assume increased salience with rising international tension, policy uncertainty, distributional concerns, and anger, especially in the West, about globalization due to factors that range beyond its economic effects. This chapter explains why trying to behave like a local citizen everywhere is unlikely to work any better for multinationals than pure localization would work with respect to the other three components of span. and the discussion of what should be done about the societal challenges facing multinational firms focuses on anger management rather than on trying to get what one wants out of the government, about which corporate public affairs professionals already tend to be pretty sophisticated. Anger appears to be inflamed by an interaction between globaloney and large degrees of partiality, how much people tend to favor others from their own country over foreigners. To counteract this anger, the chapter proposes a FRIEND, F-R-I-E-N-D, program involving facts, rhetoric, increases in international informational interactions, education, non-market strategy improvements, and distributional fixes. Even if rebuilding societal support for globalization and multinational firms is likely to take a long time, we'd better get started. This focus on anger management and non-market strategy exemplifies my intent for this book to address present pressures on globalization with insights that will also stand the test of time. History suggests that sentiments about globalization will continue to yo-yo, but that the laws of semi-globalization and distance will endure, and that recommendations grounded in those laws can help firms manage their way through the turbulence and even profit from it. The global roadmap keeps changing, but those changes largely conform to predictable patterns. If it were otherwise, I would be much more skeptical about the abilities of today's multinationals to surmount the challenges that they face, and would not have written this book. Part 1. Mapping Globalization. What is and isn't changing? Part 1 maps the present state of globalization and examines how the international environment is changing over time. Chapter 1 debunks popular and dangerous myths that prevent managers from thinking clearly about globalization while introducing a pair of laws on which firms can ground their international strategies. Chapter 2 stress tests those laws, considering the twin shocks of Brexit and the Trump presidency, as well as the historical experience of the last global trade war in the 1930s. Chapter 3 examines how the rise of emerging economies is likely to impact globalization over a longer time horizon. Chapter 1. The State of Globalization. How globalized is the world today? And has globalization been increasing or decreasing? Believe it or not, many managers can't answer those basic questions correctly, even though the wrong answers can lead to costly business blunders. In other words, managers' mental maps of globalization tend to be highly distorted. Some of the distortion doubtless reflects the turbulence of the environment, which can widen the gap between perceptions and reality. Some distortion might reflect media noise. The media are particularly prone to yo-yoing, since no one ever attracted more eyeballs by declaring that, quote, not much has changed, unquote. And quite a bit of misinformation reflects powerful biases that operate at the personal and interpersonal level, and that will be discussed in some detail later in this chapter. But first, the good news. There are stable patterns behind the turbulence on which firms can build strategies for sustained success. This chapter uses up-to-date data to present two laws of globalization and to debunk dangerous myths. This characterization of the state of globalization sets the stage for the analysis of how various types of shocks might change globalization in the short to medium run and in the long run. These assessments of globalization offer different time frames, then underpin the recommendations for what firms should do about globalization. I begin this chapter by confronting the news headlines about globalization's trajectory with hard data on international flows of trade, capital, information, and people. Because the available evidence does not indicate that globalization has gone into reverse, at least not yet, I turn next to a finer-grained examination of what I refer to as the depth and breadth of globalization. This assessment provides a clearer view of how globalized the world is today. It also illustrates two regularities that are so powerful they merit recognition as scientific laws: the law of semi-globalization and the law of distance. I also present data from a multi-country survey that highlights how managers tend to believe that the world is far more globalized than it really is. The chapter therefore concludes with a discussion of the steep costs such exaggerated perceptions, or globaloney, impose upon companies and the world at large. Globalization in retreat? The 2008 global financial crisis shattered the confidence about globalization's prospects that had dominated the public and corporate discourse at least since 2001, when China joined the World Trade Organization, or WTO, and memories of the 1997 Asian financial crisis began to fade. In the span of just 3 weeks in 2015, the Washington Post ran one headline declaring, quote, "globalization at warp speed," unquote, and then another asking, quote, "the end of globalization," unquote. Ambiguity reigned. Then came Brexit. To use the same newspaper as a bellwether, after the June 2016 referendum, the Washington Post published an article bearing the headline, quote, "Britain just killed globalization as we know it," unquote. Returning the favor, after Trump's election, The Guardian in the United Kingdom starkly proclaimed, quote, "globalization is dead," unquote. These two newspapers weren't alone in their pessimism. A broader tonal analysis of newspaper stories mentioning globalization reveals a sharply negative turn from 2015 to 2016. On average, negative stories outnumbered positive ones in 2016 by a factor of 4-1 in the United States and by 2-1 in the United Kingdom and India. Pessimism about globalization carried over from the newsstand to the bookstore, with titles such as From Global to Local appearing in 2017 and Us Versus Them, The Failure of Globalism, in 2018. Public and business sentiment about globalization was clearly on a downswing. But we've seen this before, and perceptions can veer far away from reality. Do the facts support such a bleak depiction of globalization's trajectory? In light of hard data, the answer is no. My colleagues Stephen Altman and I compile the biennial DHL Global Connectedness Index, which measures international interactions across 140 countries, accounting for 99% of the world's economic output and 95% of its population. The most recent edition, released in November 2016, tracked international flows of trade, capital, information, and people from 2005 through 2015. Although globalization was hit hard during the 2008 to 2009 financial crisis, it recovered and eventually surpassed its pre-crisis peak in 2014. And although globalization slowed in 2015, it had not, at least as of the end of the period studied, shifted into reverse. The index aggregates across the depth and the breadth of globalization. Depth captures how much of flows that could take place either domestically or internationally cross national borders. Breadth focuses on the flows that are international and measures whether they're dispersed globally or more concentrated, for example, among neighboring countries. To focus first on depth, we can unpack trends along the four pillars of the index: trade, capital, information, and people. Trade, measuring both merchandise and services trade, turns out to be the only pillar on a multi-year decline. Capital, based on flows and stocks of FDI and portfolio equity, fell the farthest at the onset of the financial crisis, but has recovered somewhat since 2011. Information, capturing international telephone calls, international internet bandwidth, and trade in printed material, has surged over the last decade, although the increase in its depth is moderated by the explosion in domestic information flows that has also taken place. And while visa and work permit restrictions continue to constrain migration, the steady growth of international tourism has been driving consistent increases in international people flows. Although the depth of trade and capital flows remained below their pre-crisis peaks, the depth of globalization as a whole had clearly not gone into retreat through 2015. And even the large drop-off in trade depth was almost entirely a price effect, driven by plunging commodity prices and the growing strength of the US dollar. The value of merchandise trade fell 13% in dollar terms in 2015, but trade volume grew a modest 2.6%. If the depth of globalization shows no signs of having collapsed, what about its breadth? While breadth can be measured in several ways, given breathless predictions of the, quote, death of distance, unquote, the average distance traversed by international flows supplies a convenient metric. If the breadth of interactions was shrinking, one might expect distances to become shorter. In fact, the opposite is true. If we plot the average distance covered by the flows included in the DHL Global Connectedness Index, we notice that international flows continued to stretch across greater distances through 2015. This expansion has slowed, however, compared to its brisk pace between 2008 and 2010, a period when the share of flows from emerging markets, which tend to interact over greater distances, was rising swiftly, and when firms from crisis-hit countries desperately sought growth far from home. In short, neither depth nor breadth metrics indicate that globalization declined over the decade in question, although its growth has slowed. Devoted gloom and doomers might retort that these metrics don't tell the whole story, and that 2016 or 2017 data will reflect a decline. Maybe, but not yet. Limited data from the year of Brexit and Trump points to more of the same, namely, close to flat trade and FDI depth. Trade depth declined less in 2016 than in 2015, and preliminary data shows it growing in the first two quarters of 2017. And even though FDI flows in 2015 were inflated by a wave of overseas corporate inversions by U.S. companies, the wave ended in April 2016, when the U.S. Treasury issued new rules cracking down on such transactions, FDI depth surrendered only a fraction of its prior year increase. Data across all the components of the DHL Global Connectedness Index isn't available yet, but factoring in people and information flows will probably reinforce the conclusion that neither Leave nor America First has managed to stop globalization, let alone throw it into reverse. Depth and the law of semi-globalization. Since globalization has not collapsed, at least not yet, its future prospects are the subject of the next two chapters. We can look for useful patterns in the data to examine in more detail how globalized the world really is today. We'll see how the depth and breadth of globalization supply evidence for my proposed laws of globalization across many types of international activity and over time. My first law of globalization can be summarized as follows. International interactions, while not negligible, are significantly less intense than domestic interactions. In other words, national borders still present formidable barriers to international interactions, but the flows that do get across them are too significant to allow firms to focus exclusively on domestic opportunities and threats. I call this the law of semi-globalization because it highlights how the depth of globalization is significantly above zero, but still far smaller than it would be in a perfectly integrated world. For any type of activity that could happen either within or across national borders, I divide the amount of international activity by the total activity, international plus domestic. The average depth ratio is about 20%. Not only is domestic activity much more intense than international activity, domestic activity also almost always far surpasses international activity in absolute terms. Given the centrality of trade to debates about globalization, the multiple trade metrics merit more explanation. Gross exports of goods and services as a percentage of gross domestic product, or GDP, 28% in 2016, is the simplest and most commonly cited measure of trade depth. It is calculated by summing up the shipment values tallied by customs agencies around the world and dividing by total output. But because the same content can cross borders more than once in multi-country supply chains, gross exports depth overstates the proportion of output that is traded. Exports depth based on trade in value-added terms removes such double counting and indicates that exports really account for closer to 20% of world output rather than nearly 30%. Adjusting the multi-country supply chains also highlights how much more intensively goods are traded than services. Exports account for about 40% of value added in goods-producing sectors, agriculture and industry, but only 15% in services. This way of looking at trade depth also helps address objections that some kinds of output are not tradable. Most of what is impossible to trade is in the service sector, but even in goods-producing sectors alone, actual trade falls well short of what would be expected if borders and distance didn't matter. Under such counterfactual conditions, theory suggests that about 92% of goods produced around the world would be exported. Given the persistent hype about the internet and other technological developments ushering in a borderless future, I devote special attention to measures of the depth of information flows. Despite the supposedly magical immaterial qualities of digital goods and services, and no matter what kind of technology is employed, information flows remain far more intense within rather than between countries. This pattern applies to everything from snail mail to overall internet traffic to particular types of online activity, such as page views on news websites, videos trending on YouTube, and relationships on social media. The only depth metric surpassing 50% is for movies. This ratio will probably fall as alternatives to Hollywood blockbusters continue gaining ground. China, in particular, is making a big push to grow its domestic film industry. Looking across countries rather than types of activity, The law of semi-globalization holds even in Singapore, the country that topped the 2016 DHL Global Connectedness Index depth ranking, as well as my city-level globalization hotspots index. Even though Singapore trades far more than it produces or consumes, if you remove transshipments and the like, more than half of all the output consumed or invested in Singapore comes from inside Singapore itself, even though Singapore constitutes just 0.4% of the world economy. The law of semi-globalization has also held over a long historical period. Even as the depth of globalization for many variables has increased, in 1820, exports still added up to less than 3% of world GDP. But between the late 19th and early 20th centuries, exports depth increased from 8% to 15%, and FDI stocks started to register as significant as well. After an interwar slump, analyzed further in Chapter 2, international flows began to deepen again in the second half of the 20th century. By the beginning of the 21st century, international flows were mostly well into record territory, with immigrant intensity and broad capital mobility representing two notable exceptions. Because of this evolution, most business leaders do appreciate that international activity has grown too big to ignore. The aspect of the law of semi-globalization that many have not recognized is that international interactions are still significantly less intense than domestic ones. And even when people do understand that borders matter, they tend to underestimate by how much. Most people, including CEOs, countries' envoys to the WTO, MBA students, and members of the general public, overestimate these metrics by a wide margin. Using a common set of metrics across multiple surveys, I've asked these kinds of questions of tens of thousands of people across several dozen countries. The average respondent overestimates the depth of globalization by 5 times. Later in this chapter, I present more on why people believe so much globaloney and why it matters. Managers, in particular, tend to guess no more accurately than other groups. And while they could perhaps be forgiven for not being more clued in about the country-level metrics, the inaccuracy of their intuition about the firm-level indicators is more startling. Multinationals are exceedingly rare. Less than 1 in 1,000 firms, 0.1%, have foreign operations, and only about 1% export. Of course, since multinationals are, on average, much larger than their domestic counterparts, their contributions to global economic activity are larger. The operations of multinational firms outside of their home countries generate about 3% of employment and 11% of output. But these values are still far shy of the 30 to 40% respectively that managers typically guess them to be. I'll discuss how we can use the law of semi-globalization throughout the rest of this book. But for now, note that the depth metrics and, by extension, the law of semi-globalization should guide firms about the extent to which business decisions should be based predominantly on domestic versus international considerations. Where depth is low, domestic market conditions, regulations, cultural preferences, and so on should dominate. Where depth is high, managers have to devote more attention to international flows. In those cases, by extension, my second law of globalization, pertaining to its breadth rather than depth, becomes more salient. Breadth and the law of distance. Now that we've considered the proportion of activity that takes place within versus across national borders, let's examine the smaller subset of flows that do cross national borders. Here, the second law of globalization, the law of distance, comes into play. International interactions are dampened by distance along cultural, administrative, and geographic dimensions, and are often affected by economic distance as well. In other words, distance isn't dead or dying.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.